ministers designate for the interior and justice vetted by parliament.
Hello, good evening. You're most welcome to our studios, GBC24 and Ghana Television. My name is Micheline Taka.
And my name is Akpene Avo Ajaja. Time now for News Hour. The ministers designate for the interior and attorney general and minister for justice have appeared before the appointments committee of parliament.
Mr. Ambrose Derry and Madame Gloria Akufu were quizzed on issues relating to national security and delays in the justice delivery system.
The Interior Minister Designate, Mr. Ambrose Derry, was the first to appear before the committee on his second day of sitting. Mr. Derry, a lawyer, has served in various capacities such as Deputy Attorney General and Upper West Regional Minister. He was also a Deputy Minority Leader of Parliament. He answered questions about security and his plans to prioritize the National Barracks Regeneration Program that will ensure decent accommodation for security officers.
We have stated in our manifesto that it will be a National Barracks Regeneration Program. And yes, PPP arrangements, one of the options. I do know that from the briefings that I've got that prison is considering the same approach. So yes, the investment could come through the PPP arrangements, but we do so always conscious of value for money and ensuring that we give the country the best deal they can get.
On the recent incidences of seizures of government property across the country, Mr. Ambrose Derry promised to deal with the issue.
Crime has no political color, no partisan color. And when we are too partisan, the only beneficiaries are the offenders and the criminals. And what is going to happen is that Ghana is not going to be the safe place for the necessary economic activity resulting in the economic development that we want. And it is also important to let individual citizens know that there is no vicarious liability in criminal offenses. That if any group tells you go and do wrong and you do, the furthest they will go is accompany you to the court. And when you are convicted, they will look on you in helpless sympathy.
Madame Gloria Akufu was the second and the last to be vetted for the day. She's also a lawyer and served as a deputy attorney general in the Akufo administration. She was queried on matters bordering on the constitution, delays in the justice delivery system, among others. She was asked about the setting up of an independent special prosecutor as promised by the NPP in its 2016 manifesto.
The proposed independent prosecutor's office is intended to be one of the ways that will deal specifically with the canker of corruption in the public sector. It is true that by the Constitution, the Attorney General has the power to prosecute criminal matters, but it also has the power to delegate that authority. And it is under that that the office will be set up with a specific remit to deal with public sector corruption.
The judgment death case of Mr. Wayomi also came up.
Judgment has been entered for the refund of the money. Efforts to refund, to recover the money have been inundated with many applications. My understanding is that the execution process has been stalled with all these processes. I will go to office and look. That is why I said in the beginning that I cannot make categorical undertakings that if you give me approval tomorrow, I can recover the money, because this is a matter which is subject to litigation. I can only say that when I get there, I'll study the file and see how quickly we can recover the money.
The Appointments Committee of Parliament will continue on Monday, the 23rd of January 2017. Renewed from GBC24, Accra.
In some more stories this hour, the Controller and Accountant General's Department has denied messages on social media that some staff of the department are asking for pay slips and bank details of workers in order to assist them with the payment of their salary arrears. In a statement, the department also refuted messages alleging that the controllers payroll system has been hacked and workers' staff identification numbers have been obtained fraudulently. The statement said no staff of the department has been taxed to demand payslips or bank details of any worker in order to pay arrears. The department assures Ghanaians that its payroll system has not been hacked into by any individual or group of persons, and therefore no personal information of staff on the government payroll system has been compromised. The statement cautions the public, especially those paid through the government's payroll system, to be mindful of such dubious messages.
In Gulinga, land leveling in agriculture is done to enhance efficiency in water and fertilizer, nutrient, and to improve crop stand and yield. With the introduction of a modern technology for land leveling in the northern region, rice farmers in the Gulinga community in the Tolon district are expecting increased yield with minimum inputs and labor.
Land preparation is an important ingredient to high crop yield according to modern farming principles. Unevenness to the soil surface has a significant impact on the germination, stand and yield of a crop. However, traditional methods of leveling land are cumbersome, time-consuming as well as expensive. Studies suggest that during irrigation, water ranging from 25 to 30% is lost during application at the farm due to poor farm designing and unevenness of the field. This problem is more pronounced in the case of sugar and rice fields. Indeed, fields that are not leveled have uneven crop stand, increased weed burden, and uneven maturing crops. At a demonstration of modern technology equipment organized by Agromite, an organization specialized in agriculture modernization technology for field leveling at Gulinga, the consultant and lecturer at the University of Ghana, Dr. Henry Enimsoa, explained the rationale for this modern technology and some of its achievements to Ghanaian rice farmers.
We are addressing the sustainability issue by providing training. And also you can see now we are training tractor operators on how to use this. The second level we're doing is that we're also training on maintenance to ensure that all these we can maintain. In the third phase, the collaboration is to enable us manufacture this locally to ensure that it's sustainable. In the affordability, we may say today it is affordable to smallholders through our service provision. The technology, as you said, is new and a little complex. And so we're looking at smallholder farmers accessing the service rather than owning it.
The chairman of the Gulinga Rice Farmers Association, Malam Shaibu, commended the consultants for introducing the technology to the farmers. He said even though they have been in the cultivation of rice for a while, their incomes are nothing to write home about due to their lack of technical know-how in the business. He appealed to government to provide them with credit facilities to enable them expand their farms.
The Chinese ambassador to Ghana, Madam San Banhung, has inaugurated an ICT center equipped with the latest technology for the pupils of Mepong Presby Junior High School in the Eastern Region. Funded by China, it will enable school pupils in the area to have access to the ICT lab and internet facilities.
Ghana has not been left out of the information and communication technology revolution. Pupils of Mepong Presby Junior High School are to benefit from an ICT center worth over 91,000 Ghana cedis and other educational materials. The school, which was in a deplorable state, has been renovated with the provision of new chairs and tables. The district director of education, West Akim, Mr. Moses Tete, advised the pupils and teachers to patronize the center. He said if the facility is properly utilized, students would perform well, especially in the Basic Education Certificate Examination, BECE. Mrs. Esla Owusu-Ekufo, who is the Minister Designate for Communication,
urged managers of the center to maintain the facility. The General Secretary of the Ghana-China Friendship Association, Mr. Danny Esmond, said the association is poised to help rural folks to benefit from ICT. The Chinese Ambassador to Ghana, Madame Sung Wang Hong, said China is promoting cooperation in equipment manufacturing in order to speed up Ghana's industrialization.
The new Patriotic Party government is committed to improving the economic situation in Ghana, achieving industrialization and economic transformation, and upgrading through measures of one district, one factory, one village, one dam, and $1 million annual fund for each constituency.
The MP for Craig constituency, who doubles as Minister Designate for Regional Reorganization Development, Mr. Daniel Butri, said the use of ICT has become imperative, that no meaningful development can take place without ICT. He said the center will not only benefit Mipom Presby GHS, but all the surrounding schools. Farm tools such as agriculture spraying machines, Wellington boots and cutlasses were donated to the people of Sukrong, a suburb of Adeso. The chiefs called on the government to provide the community with a senior high school. At the commissioning of the East Mampusi District Fire Service Station at Gambaga, the Chief Fire Officer, Dr. Albert Brown-Gazi, repeated calls for the public to adhere to safety precautions to prevent fires. He mentioned negligence and ignorance as some factors that lead to domestic fires.
Even though the East Mampusi district is the first regional capital in the northern region, it has never had a fire station. The construction of the new fire service station is therefore seen as a novelty. The new station is equipped with a brand new fire tender. The chief fire officer, Dr. Albert Brown-Gazi, called for effective collaboration between the people and the fire service to help fight domestic fires, adding that firefighting is not the sole responsibility of the Ghana National Fire Service alone. He said, with the onset of the Harmattan and the fact that more fires are recorded at this time, it is necessary to construct the station. He challenged the personnel to intensify patrols and extinguish naked fire to avoid unfortunate disasters. Dr. Brown-Gazi also advised the personnel to put the facility into good use to ensure its longevity.
Acquiring a property is a different thing. Maintaining it is another thing. We shall periodically visit the station, and I expect to see that the investment that the community and assembly have put in place will not be in vain. Ensure the regular maintenance of the fire engine.
The district chief executive for Gambaga, Magnus Jacob Yama Tampuri, advised all citizens to avail themselves for fire education to avoid preventable fires and ultimately protect lives and property. He appealed to the chief fire officer to consider enlisting some youth of the area into the service to enable them to serve the district. Mr. Tampuri pledged the assembly's support to regularly maintain the facility. Dr. Brown-Gazi and his entourage earlier paid a courtesy call on the overlord of Mampuru, Nabonhagi Mahami Abdullahi Shirigu. The overlord urged the people to cooperate with the personnel to enable them to discharge their duty effectively. The chief fire officer was enskinned by the overlord as a king of fire.
A 36-year-old female, Isaha Kuanifa, suffering from kidney failure, is appealing to the general public for assistance to enable her undergo corrective surgery. Isahaku Anifa was diagnosed of end-stage renal disease at the Tamale Teaching Hospital. She is currently on maintenance chronic hemodialysis stage, a process where her blood is passed through a machine to be cleaned for about 4 hours. According to a medical report available to GBC's Radio Savannah, she undergoes treatment 3 times a week at the cost of 250 Ghana cedis per session. The family of Isaha Kuanifa say they can no longer afford the treatment and are calling for public support. Madame Anifa needs to undergo a kidney transplant at a cost of 60,000 Ghana cedis. Contributions can be sent to Dokurungu Sumani account number 801-200-001-123-7301 at the ADB main branch Tamale, or contact 0208-399-837. This is News Hour live on GBC24. We'll be back shortly with some more stories. Do stay with us.
Reporters Roundtable provides viewers with in-depth examination of issues reported on leading media outlets across the world. A lively panel of journalists with comprehensive knowledge in all fields of endeavor, be it politics, health, business, sports, entertainment, information, communication technology, gender, law, international affairs and diplomacy, and a host of others will objectively dissect the matter of contention. On Reporters Roundtable, fairness, objectivity, factuality, and non-partisanship is our hallmark. It's the Double RT Show with Rebecca Iwa. This and every other Thursday from 10 to 12 GMT. Make a date with us. The Reporters Roundtable. All angles, all sides.
Segment. Thanks for staying on. To enhance currency authentication in financial institutions, All Sales Services Limited has taken the lead by launching its SB9 front office currency authentication machine. The innovative counterfeit detector also offers best solutions to counting and mixed denomination challenges. The unique counter, which combines numerous value detecting properties, comes with a year warranty and has a lifespan of 10 years.
All Sales Services Limited was established in June 9, 2004 to provide the state-of-the-art money processing and office equipment solutions to financial and non-financial institutions. All Sales Services Limited is an IT-oriented solutions company that deals in sales, leasing, servicing and assembly. Starting as a sole proprietorship, the company is now a limited liability. The company in 2008, through research and development program, developed its own brands of equipment. The All Count money counting machine, crane, fireproof security safes, cabinets, all cool air conditioners, among others. The company now has a new product, which is a counterfeit detector. The SB9 front office currency authentication machine can count the Ghana cedi, US dollar, pound sterling, euro and other international currencies. The SB9 has special features and can print product serial numbers in different qualities with a combination of CIS, VIS, UV, MG, IR and 3D technology. Since 2010, All Sales Services Limited has worked hard to see the SB9 accepted into the Ghanaian market, and after rigorous tests, the Bank of Ghana gave the nod to officially outdoor its new innovation. The Managing Director of All Sales, Mr. Ahmed Adadebuache, said one unique feature about the SB9 is its upgradable quality, so there is no need to discard the counter when there is change in currency.
If the Bank of Ghana reissue, let's say, a different 50 cedi with different features, all other machines may reject that particular addition because it's not in the database of their software. But the good thing about the SB9 is that we can scan that particular reissued note, the features, all the attributes, and then just input it in the software of the SB9, then it will be able to take it. So the future is very bright.
With drawing sold notes from circulating in the system, is as important as injecting fresh banknotes, according to a former deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana, Mr. Emmanuel Asiedumante. Fake currency notes abound in almost every part of the world, including Ghana. Hence, the need for an inbuilt sensor counting machine that tracks, identifies, and eliminates counterfeits, and was happy the new SB9 detector has been introduced to minimize the challenge.
If confidence is going to be maintained in these kind of substitutes, then the central bank, together with the banks, the deposit money banks, need to boost the security features of electronic payment systems. I believe that the SB9 that has been certified by the Bank of Ghana has all the requisite properties to meet these challenges.
A representative from the manufacturers in South Korea, Mr. Arthur Kim, said the SB9 is the world's smallest counterfeit detector. He added that with a business relation between Ghana and South Korea, more innovations would be introduced. With well-trained technicians from Ghana and abroad, reliability for banks and other companies is assured. All Sales Services Limited is the only Ghanaian company with the SB9 front office currency authentication machine. Dorothy Ajumai, GBC24, Accra.
Total cash prize of 250,000 Ghana cedis has been awarded to 11 customers in the Vodafone Yetriko promo. The winner of the promo for the month of December 2016 received 30,000 Ghana cedis, while the overall winner received a cash prize of 150,000 Ghana cedis.
Vodafone's Yetriko promotion was announced in October 2015 to celebrate 6 years of service to Ghanaians and to reward its loyal customers. The director of marketing, Mrs. Agnes Issa, explained that the Yetriko promotion allows Vodafone to interact with its customers across the country. She said apart from the monthly cash prizes, there is still more to be won with the points accrued from the scratch cards.
We chose a Yetriko promotion because we know that it will allow us to interact with a lot of our consumers and make people win a lot to reward their loyalty. So we set out to reward 170,000, but in the end we rewarded 270,000 consumers on this program. And also the thing to note is that with all the points that people have built, don't worry, right from the end of January, those points can be used to redeem airtime. So it's not a waste at all. Some people...
Time to take a break. We'll be back shortly with Mind Journey Tuesday.
This is Moment Tonight. My name is Moment. I am seated here by the grip side of Sergeant Ajete. We bring you the real stories.
Everybody in Ghana about the age of 18 has seen somebody naked before.
It's not all people who are infected with Ebola who show that bleeding tendencies.
It means that we have to share load or else the system will collapse.
The real issues, the real talk.
I'm not haunted by the fear of failure. I'm always inspired by the challenge of success.
The leadership of the country believe in democracy.
Development also rides on the back of very strong institutions.
Topical issues of corruption and accountability.
Moment Tonight, from Monday to Friday, 8:15 p.m. to 9:15 p.m. on GBC24.
Welcome back to the news, and this is the My Journey segment. If you've lived or worked in Accra or any big city for that matter for any length of time and do not own a car, then you may be familiar with the hassle of traveling on public transport. From fights with a conductor to arguments about fares and crowding, these trips are far from comfortable. In a fast-paced and densely populated city like Accra, a bus rapid transit system is a critical tool to ensuring swift mobility for socioeconomic reasons. Thelma Taki and a crew took a ride on one of the Ayalolo buses, which are gradually gaining popularity on the city's eastern corridor. There are a few hiccups, but commuters appear largely optimistic about the potential for this Western-style bus transport system which runs from Tudu to Amasaman here in Accra.
Ayalolo, which literally means "we are still going" in the Ghana language, is the name of a neighborhood in Accra. Now, the name is also synonymous with the bus rapid transit system. The Ayalolo buses were inaugurated on the 25th November 2016 and started commercial activities on 1st December 2016. The only route in operation for now is Tudu, Achimota, Ofanko, Amasaman. Special cards with top-up when credit runs out are needed to board the Ayalolo bus. Purchasing a travel card is easy from any departure or arrival terminal. Some industrious young men have also got into the business of buying the cards and selling them at some bus stops for the same price. A brand new card sells for 5 Ghana cedis from any departure or arrival terminal. A new card at the time of purchase comes with 2 Ghana cedis 90 pesos credit already loaded on it and can be topped up at any bus stop or by using mobile money, just like a mobile phone top-up. A minimum of 2 Ghana cedis 50 pesos is always needed on the card before a journey begins. Upon boarding the bus, a commuter needs to tap the card on a reader that validates whether there is sufficient funds on the card for the journey. Entry is granted only after validation and cash is not acceptable. The cost of each travel is dependent on where a passenger boards the bus and where they get off.
When you are boarding from Tudu Terminal, we have 4 zones on the corridor. Depending on which zones you are traveling in, the bus charges according to the zones. The first zone is from here to Circle, that is one zone. From Circle to Achimota is another zone. From Achimota to Ofanko is another zone. From Ofanko to Amasama is another zone. So we have basically 4 zones on the corridor. You are from here, you are going to Amasama. It will charge you 2 cedis, 50 pesos. For now, they are still working on it. For here to Ofanko, it will take 2 cedis, 50 pesos. But to Achimota New Station, it will take 1 cedi, 92 pesos.
The bus is tracked on GPS for speeding or delay and the driver advised accordingly. It has a priority area for persons less able to stand, which include pregnant women, persons carrying babies and persons using a walking stick. A special space is also designated for persons using a wheelchair and an attendant. At the back of every seat, there is a USB port for charging portable devices like phones and tablets. There is a luggage bay for passengers, but the space is limited.
There are complaints that we don't take market women. The market women, if you are, you can take it, but if you are having more load, the bus cannot take it. You just take small load. So like you can see here, that's where we keep the load.
There is an emergency evacuation system where the windows can be opened by pulling the levers. An automated voice system announces the next bus stop on speaker and pressing a buzzer alerts the driver if a passenger wants to alight. Despite the obvious comfort of the buses, many of which are fully air-conditioned and some with free Wi-Fi, patronage of the Ayalolo buses has been slow, mainly because of lack of adequate awareness on the service and how it operates.
A lot of education is going on. We have customer service people on the buses that are doing a lot. When we started Ayalolo, we were given free ride. So it is the willingness of people to understand what we are offering, not what they think we should offer.
Patrons of the Ayalolo buses say the system is quick, as it saves at least 30 minutes when compared to Trotro. They say it is convenient and has potential to be better if the slight changes are addressed.
From Ofanko Barrier to Tudu, it took me around like 40 minutes to get to Tudu. And the bus is fun, you know, there is space for you to feel comfortable in the bus. And you can charge your phone as you come. But my only difficulty in this bus is, like, you find it difficult to check the balance on your card. That's the only difficulty I have. But all the same, it's fun using this bus.
There are some suburbs. Somewhere like Ofanko like this, is serving about 6 buses. And there are others that is serving just about 2. Even the most furthest places like Amasaman. And so when these Amasaman people come here, they can stay here for hours before their bus come. And so I think they should sit down and then share the buses to all the suburbs, so that when the passengers come here, they don't keep long.
The challenge is with their system. When you upload or you load money onto the card using your phone, sometimes it gives you issue. It takes time for it to be recognized on the card. Probably you've loaded it in an hour and you want to join the bus, they'll tell you your money isn't sufficient, which is sometimes worrying. And I think the drivers should be a little bit patient with the passengers. When they show them the phone that they've loaded and there's a message, they should allow them to join. Then next time they can, the deduction could take place.
Passengers say topping up the Ayalolo card is sometimes problematic as the network systems delay. Operators of the buses say obstructions at their bus stops by other vehicles is a concern. So is the fact that the dedicated bus lanes are not solely used by the Ayalolo buses, which causes further delay.
Officials running the Ayalolo buses are telling us that engineers are working around the clock to fix the problems that arise with topping up the cards. In the meantime, they are asking other bus drivers on the corridor to respect the Ayalolo bus terminals so as to reduce the travel time even further.
There are currently 245 buses in the Ayalolo fleet. 25 of these are running now on three routes: Amasaman Tudu, Afankor Tudu, and Achimota Tudu. Operators say there are scheduled departures every 20 minutes to and from Amasaman. A bus also leaves every 10 minutes to and from Achimota and Afankor Tudu. Though traffic makes it hard to give definite times at bus stops, operators say they should be expected every 10 to 20 minutes. Buses to Adenta, Tema Beach Road and Kasua are expected to be introduced once the required terminals and stops are completed.
And that's it for the My Journey segment of the news. It's still News Are Live on GBC24. Now, a total cash prize of 250,000 Ghana cedis has been awarded to 11 customers in the Vodafone NutriCorp promotion.
The Vodafone NutriCorp promo was launched in October last year. The promo was structured for customers to win cash prizes at the end of every month and a grand cash prize at the end of December. The idea is to motivate customers to top up more Vodafone credits for calls and data bundle activation. For December 2016, four winners received 5,000 Ghana cedis each, and the winner for the month received 30,000 Ghana cedis. For the grand prizes, five winners received 10,000 Ghana cedis each, with the overall winner taking home 150,000 cedis. Philip Piato, the winner of the month of December 2016, was grateful to Vodafone for the prize.
I'm very grateful to Vodafone for giving this opportunity and more especially giving us all a good time.
The overall winner, Kalaya Goto, commended Vodafone for bringing the promotion. He intends to invest the money into a business.
It's a good feeling because the company has empowered me financially. As I stand me, a young guy coming up, 150,000 right now in Ghana, would do a lot for me.
The head of mass segment for Vodafone, Mr. Richmond Asante, said touching lives and giving back to society is one of Vodafone's trademarks.
This is one of the ways that Vodafone always says thank you to its customers. It's not the end. We keep finding different and creative ways to say thank you to our customers. I will encourage everyone out there who is not a Vodafone subscriber yet to get themselves on the Vodafone network and look out for the big things that are yet to come.
Vodafone recharge cards and souvenirs were given out at the event.
It's about exposing the vulnerabilities women face.
But you are in a peculiar situation. You are pregnant.
Yes. I've told that point already. My family is a small family. And my father too is old man. He cannot work again. That's why I'm pregnant and I come here.
It's about being ready to speak out for our own rights.
We are saying that surrogacy unregulated is dangerous for our society.
the authorities should get up and put regulations in place. Otherwise, we are putting our young women at risk.
We are always striving to reach the top, no matter what.
I was chosen not because I was a woman. I was chosen because when I went for the interview, I seemed to have everything that the Ghana Chamber of Mines wanted.
We are frank about who we are.
I deal with mostly women. Even though I deal with men, most of my clients are women. And you know, we women, I don't know really.
And in today's world, we do have a say.
Actually, they are dead drunk. We do have a voice. With that voice, we can change the world. With that voice, we can take command of our broken community.
Women's Voice, weekdays on GBC24 at 4 p.m. and on Mondays and Thursdays on GTV at 4 p.m. Women's Voice, articulating the issues affecting women and sharing their unique stories with the rest of the world.
The Black Stars continued with their excellent start to the ongoing AFCON competition. They recorded their second win of the competition by beating Mali by a 2-0. The goal was scored by the captain. And back here in Accra, some jubilant supporters could not hide their joy after the referee blew his whistle for the end of the game. Here are some reactions.
Now you look at his whistle, he'll blow, and Ghana are in to the quarterfinals. They had to work hard.
We didn't give them that hearing that they could do it, but they proved to us that anytime, any day, when Ghanaians, when the pressure is down for them, they can deliver. And as we have all seen today, they have proven to the world that this African Cup is coming back to Ghana. Whether they like it or not, if it is one goal project or whatever, we are bringing it back home.
Yeah, I think Ghana have done well, but to my understanding and my belief, Ghana cannot bring this cup to Ghana.
I thank God that Ghana has won, because what we need is the 3 points. And with the 3 points, we always be climbing up. But I'm praying for God to let the government head and supporters to move, so we all go and support the Black Stars, cheering them up.
They need to get some supporters there to support the Black Stars. They are doing marvelously well. We've won 2 matches, and I know that we'll go all the way to win the trophy.
I could vividly recollect what has transpired at Brazil, South Africa, when we went to the 2010 World Cup. It's like we've realized that there was one good project that we encountered there. So today, when we scored the one goal, I realized that that's the only goal we are going to score. So we are going to continue with this one goal project and definitely bring the cup back.
I'm very proud today. I'm a Ghanaian, and Ghana will surely take the cup.
And that was the sports news. We'll be back shortly with some arts stories. Just stay with us.
Reporters Roundtable provides viewers with in-depth examination of issues reported on leading media outlets across the world. A lively panel of journalists with comprehensive knowledge in all fields of endeavor, be it politics, health, business, sports, entertainment, information, communication technology, gender, law, international affairs and diplomacy, and a host of others will objectively dissect the matter of contention. On Reporters Roundtable, fairness, objectivity, factuality, and non-partisanship is our hallmark. It's the Double RT Show with Rebecca Iwa. This and every other Thursday from 10 to 12 GMT. Make a date with us. The Reporters Roundtable. All angles, all sides.
This is Moment Tonight. My name is Moment. I am seated here by the grip side of Sergeant Ajete.
We bring you the real stories.
Everybody in Ghana about the age of 18 has seen somebody naked before.
It's not all people who are infected with Ebola who show that bleeding tendencies.
It means that we have to share load or else the system will collapse.
The real issues, the real talk.
I'm not haunted by the fear of failure. I'm always inspired by the challenge of success.
The leadership of the country believe in democracy.
Development also rides on the back of very strong institutions.
Topical issues of corruption and accountability.
Moment tonight from Monday to Friday, 8:15 p.m. to 9:15 p.m. on GBC24.
Welcome back. A two-day children's film screening festival is underway in Accra. The festival, a brainchild of the state broadcaster GBC and supported by UNICEF, will give children a voice and also express their opinion on what they want for programming on television.
School here is not like anything at home. It can be crazy.
The Children's Film Festival brings together pupils from various public and private schools to screen and critique documentaries and other programs. This, according to organizers, will allow content developers and producers factor into their designs what children want to see on their screens. This is the second event to be held in about 6 years. During the five-hour screening, there were 150 children from various schools in Accra between the ages of 8 to 11 watched a documentary and two drama series, after which they critiqued and offered suggestions to them.
So they had to find other ways to entertain themselves.
He tried two times to get some water. Each time the glass broke, and then the second time the bowl broke.
And where did he get the water in the end?
He had to run all the way up to a fountain so he could put in another fish.
Mimi Dudson, a supervisor of channels at GBC, said the corporation takes content for all ages seriously, and the feedback from such exercises ensures a solid and right content for its viewers.
When we prepare programs for children, we hardly get any feedback from them. So the essence of having this is to get feedback from children. We'd like to know whether the programs that we show work for them or not. It's also to give a voice to children, at least by telling us what they feel about the programs. It means that we are not putting children in the closet, you know, we are giving them the freedom to speak their minds.
A communications officer at UNICEF, Ofebi Abedu, said it is critical for children to watch what is right, especially when they get to their decision-making age.
You know, children are agents of change. If you want something significant to happen in a community and you root it through children, the likelihood that you will succeed is very large. But over time, personally, I've realized that we don't involve children so much. So UNICEF is just giving an opening, an opportunity for GBC to say, okay, this is what we see, so that there's value added to the programs. At the end of the day, we as a society as a whole, including children, are likely to benefit from something like this.
According to GBC, the project will be an annual event. The two-day exercise ends on Sunday, 22nd January 2017, where children of ages 12 to 15 will also take their turn.
On the arts segment today, we throw the spotlight on Jamel Foster, a versatile Jamaican reggae artist making strides in his music career. Jamel's songs are mostly inspirational.